are so thankful that as we've waited for you, you showed up. We're thankful that you're in this place today. Jesus, we're thankful for your presence, and we're thankful for your spirit. We're thankful for you loving us and forgiving us and pouring out your mercy and your grace on us. For telling us that even though we don't feel worthy, we are worthy because you said we were worth it, worth dying for. And we're forever indebted to you because you first gave your life for us. So Jesus, these hands and these feet, this mouth, this tongue, this mind, we've given them to you to be used for your glory, your honor, your kingdom, you as our head, to lead us. And Lord, we'll do whatever you ask us to do. Our answer to you is yes before you even ask. Lord, we thank you for your word that you have given us. Father, we thank you for teaching us through your word and showing us your heart and making us more like you and less like ourselves. And we ask that you would give us your heart for the world.
Amen.
Jesus, we ask that you would give us your eyes for the broken. And Jesus, we ask that you would give us your hands to show and to share love, your love, Jesus, with this broken world, that many would be transformed by you, Christ. We pray these things today. And we ask that as we open your word today, that you'd speak to us, draw us closer to you, and Jesus, that you would give us a heart for people even outside of our realm of typical influence, that you'd give us heart for people in other nations, in other places, even on the Navajo Indian Reservation as we talk about that today. Give us a heart for broken people there. In Jesus' name we pray today. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God, you are good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
And whoever finds Jesus, finds life. Absolutely. Well, my name is Jeff, and I'm the lead pastor here at New Hope. And if you are visiting today, I do not believe it's an accident that you are here today. I believe that every person who comes to the doors here, God makes for a purpose. Today, he wants to speak some truth into your life, some love into your life, and I'm excited that you're here and that God's going to do that into your life today. If you are visiting, it's not going to take you long to figure out that we are not a perfect church, and that's because we're full of imperfect people like me and my brother Greg down here. But we are real serious about sharing Christ's love with people so that he can step in and transform their broken lives and our broken lives in the process. And so we're excited that you're here today. And if you're visiting, let us know you're here. There's a communication card in your bulletin that looks like this. And if you would, fill that out. And at the end of the worship hour, take it to the Welcome Center out back and exchange that with us. We got a free gift we'd love to give you. And we'd love to have a chance to connect with you that way. So please let us know that you are here today. Well, I'm excited. Next week, we are going to be launching. I'm going to be launching a new series I'm calling Sent by God. I'm going to talk about the reality of how God has called each of us who are his followers, who are disciples of Jesus, to share his love with other people and to have a heart not only for those close to us, but for the nations, for places all over the world that we don't typically think about. And we're going to learn how to become others-focused rather than self-centered throughout this series. So you don't want to miss it. We'll launch next week. Also, something great happening next week is we are bringing Jude, who works with Confluence Ministries, and he's going to be here as our guest leading us in worship next Sunday. And I've heard a lot of great things about this man, so I'm really excited about how God's going to work next Sunday. You don't want to miss next Sunday. Now, ladies, many of you I know are going to be, I think 65 of you, it's our largest women's retreat ever next week. It's going to be amazing. And so Women, you are going to be in our prayers, those of you that are going, and we're going to be praying for you all next weekend. And so there will be a lot fewer women and a lot more men next week in our worship hour. But I want you to make sure you don't miss out, guys. It's going to be incredible. And women, we love you, and we're praying for you as well. Well, today I'm really excited because Mary Jean Powers is a missionary that we support at New Hope. We've been supporting her for the last couple of years as a church, and I love what her ministry is about. She goes all over the world, and she partners with pastors and missionaries and helping disciple them and helping them disciple the people that they're winning to Christ. And she does this all over the world. And you, if you're a part of New Hope, as you give to New Hope, a small portion of what you give goes to bless her and to be a part of the work she does. And she's here with us today. Something that you may not know is that Mary Jean has been helping us at New Hope build missions into the heart of our church. This is a very slow process and a very intentional process, and she's helping us build it into the heart of New Hope biblically. So we're doing this the way Christ would if he was on earth today. And over the last few years, you don't know this yet, but you've been on a journey with me. And that journey is learning to become focused on others rather than focused on ourselves. And be a missional church who has a heart for broken people and to make an impact all over the world for Christ. And this process began last year when Mary Jean invited myself and my oldest son, Preston, to go on my first ever missions trip. And this trip was a long ways away in downtown Denver. It's quite a trip, especially during rush hour on I-25. Can I get an amen? So one of the scariest things I've ever done in my life, to be honest with you, we worked down on the streets down there, and God overcame a lot of fears in my heart. And this has become instrumental in me developing a greater heart of compassion, recognizing some of my own selfishness that I wasn't aware of, and God growing me. This year is phase two of Mary Jean's process of helping us build missions into the heart of New Hope, which is she's going to be leading myself and my family, all of my children, and my wife, and some of our other staff members at New Hope and their families on a trip the end of May to New Mexico to the Navajo Indian Reservation. And she has plans to thoroughly mess me up in the process. And I think the Holy Spirit has even bigger plans than she does to thoroughly mess with my head. And to give us greater hearts for people that are different than us, for people that are broken and need the Lord, and to help us as a church develop a greater heart for God's heart for people all over the world. And so I'm really excited about this trip, and there are ways that you can be involved. And as a whole church, in a sense, I'm going to sort of take you with me on this, in that we're all going to work together to pull together some things. Maybe when you came in today, maybe you saw one of these signs in the foyer or in the hallways as you came up. These are some things that we're going to be collecting, some personal items, some hygiene items that you can be involved in. We all want to be involved in. And then also Bibles. And Mary Jean's going to talk more about that as she shares today during the message time. And then also ways that you can contribute and really have great impact for the Lord on the Navajo Indian Reservation, that we can partner together in doing this. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome my friend, a mentor, someone that God has used to disciple me. I've been a part of a number of teachings and all day classes that Mary Jean has taught. And my life has never been the same since I've gone through. It started when you taught a worship one. God just really, really opened my heart in some big ways through that. And Mary Jean's been huge in my life. So I know that you're going to be blessed today as she shares from her heart. And we all develop a greater heart for the nations, for people who are different than us who live all over the world. So would you please welcome with me Miss Mary Jean Powers.
Thanks, Jeff. Sweetheart. Good morning.
Good morning, Mary Jean.
How are you? Yeah? Do you believe in smiling? part of your religion?
I hope so.
I used to, you know, for 35 years I was a music teacher, and I used to tell my choir all the time, would you notify your face already? Tell your face you like my class, all right? Come on. Or at least your audience, at the very least. I'm tired. Anybody with me on that one? Yeah? I send my greetings from your brothers and sisters in, well, since the beginning of the year, I've been in Mexico and Iceland, Estonia, Norway, and Sweden. And just got back this week from 3 weeks in Europe. And they say hello. They don't say it that way, but I'm a linguistic moron, and I don't speak any other languages. So I can't tell you the way they say it. Ciao, usually. Ciao. I can handle that one. Ciao. But they send their greetings, and, you know, we're going to live with them forever and ever. So all of these people that we've never met before, and that's going to be good. That's going to be good. I don't think we're going to be so tired in heaven. I don't think we're going to have these bodies that get weirder as the years go on. Anybody over 55 agree with that one? Yeah? It's a trip, isn't it? So, hi, little short person. Your body isn't changing like mine is. It's doing very different things these days. So I was, hi, sweetheart. So I am a little incoherent this week. I rode on the, so many different modes of transportation home from Estonia. And after a 6 a.m. flight, so getting up at 3:30, and then next to a man who seriously leaked over into my personal American space and put on at least a half a bottle of cologne that morning. Wow. Before the plane even took off, my head was going ba-boom, 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 you know, with smells like that, you know? And so I had 11 hours with my jacket around my nose. And by the time I got home, I was shot. Did anybody ever feel like, yeah, just your weekday or your work week is like that? But so I'm still kind of recovering from that one, between the jet lag and the altitude, and you come over to spring, and I'm so happy to see spring, but it's also allergy season, and so that's been messy. So if I just fall over, pick me up, okay, sir? Will you do that? All right, good. Be gentle, but pick me up, yeah. So that's kind of where I am, and I know we've all got our own stories, but that's mine for the week. So why don't you open your Bibles this morning before we launch into this Navajo project? Revelation chapter 7. Revelation's a fun book. Evidently, there's a whole different kind of blessing when we get Revelation, according to the Bible anyway, when we read Revelation that doesn't come from any other part of the book or any other part of the Bible. And that means God's got all kinds of special blessings that come certain ways. And I think we don't always understand that. He says, I've got a blessing for you this way if you fast, but I've got a different kind of blessing there for you that way if you become a student of my word. But if you really pray, then I've got a different kind of blessing this way. And if you read the book of Revelation, I've got a different one. According to the Bible anyway, it seems to be what he has for us. And I just love that about him, because he has so many different ways he wants to love on us and care for us and give to us and help us become like Jesus. Help us get peace. Help us get our peace back. You know, there's the Hebrew word for peace, shalom, literally means, you ready? Nothing missing, nothing broken. And the Prince of Peace came. He said, take a deep breath, because I've got some peace for you. He's saying to us, I'm at peace. Why aren't you? Come to me. I'll give you my peace. And so in all these different ways, we get to discover his peace, nothing missing, nothing broken, and become more and more transformed. One of the ways is by looking into this vision that John, the disciple John, the beloved John on the island of Patmos, he had this vision in Revelation chapter 7, starting in verse 9. He says this, after this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count. Hold on a second. I forgot to tell you something. One of the things I've been learning lately is that the gift from God that we don't often exercise when we read the Bible is our imaginations. Imagination is, it's the like the best present under the tree on Christmas morning, because it's the thing that God uses to activate faith a lot of the times. If we can picture it, if we can grab a hold of what he's got for us, even if we have never seen it before, then we can put our faith in his goodness, our faith in his unfailing love. Because God said it, I know it. Amen. That kind of a thing, you know? The writer of Hebrews talks about that a lot. And so I think one of the ways, one of the beautiful ways he's given us for that is to be people who actually use this imagination that he's given us, not for crazy, weird, perverted reasons, but to engage with his heart. And he gives us all the scripture to be able to do that. So will you join me this morning and engage your imagination as we read this and picture it, somehow picture what's happening right here. Amazing. Okay, verse 9. Let's try again. After this, I looked. Do you see yourself looking? And there before me was a great multitude, so great nobody could count them. Who was in this group of people? There were people from every nation, every tribe, every people group, every language. And they were standing in front of the throne and in front of the Lamb. And they were wearing white robes, and they were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out all together in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." And the angels were standing around the throne. Can you see them in your imagination? The angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell down on their faces before the throne, and they worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory, wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever and ever. Amen. 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 Amen." Salvation belongs to our God. Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. Let's say that together. Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. Picture yourself with that multitude so big that nobody can count. Go. Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And they all fell on their faces and worshiped him, because there is no God beside him. There is no God before him. There is no God other than him. He is the one and he is the only. And he has called us to come into his presence and draw near. And from what we get there, just the beauty of his face and his heartbeat, from what we get there, we go out and, like what Jeff said earlier, we don't look at people anymore. We see them. We stop looking at people and we start seeing people. And when we look into their eyes and we start seeing people, then we can love them well. And when we love them well, God can make his name great on earth. And that's why we know Jesus, to make God's name great on earth. Not to save my own butt out of hell. I mean, that's a fringe benefit. I'll give you that. And I'm happy about that one. I really am. But that's not the point. The point, the end all, the main goal, the reason Jesus came is to make Father's name great on the earth, to glorify the one and the only. That's why. And we get to help. We get to do that. And when I look into some of your eyes, and I look into some of your faces, and I know some of your stories, I know you're doing that. I know you're doing that. We're making God's name great. So, like Jeff said, we have this opportunity to make God's name great on the Navajo Reservation. Actually, we do right here, right now. But this is just a different kind of opportunity that's only going to be for a week. But it's a week doing something and being challenged and being changed in a way that we haven't before. And that's cool. God uses these kinds of opportunities, especially when they're uncomfortable and vulnerable, to say, okay, now I've got you in a place where you're listening, because you don't know what you're doing. And that's the story of my life. Most of the time, I don't know what I'm doing. And so he sends me around the world to help me remember that he's God and I'm not. And to work with people and encourage people. So I thought what we'd do is just see some pictures of what's going on in the Navajo Reservation. I've been going down for 19 years now and been able to do a lot of cool stuff down there, but meet some of the most amazing people ever who have changed me and challenged me. One of my biggest prayers and missions is, God, send me to places who need the message you've given me, the way I give it, but also to places where I need them. And that's a cool thing about being part of New Hope, is I need you. I really need you. I need you to become who I've been created to be. That's the way God set up the body of Christ. I need you, your love and your acceptance, and I need your encouragement. I need a lot of stuff that you give me consistently, and I thank you for that. But also, when we go to the Navajo Reservation, we need them, and that is one of the keys for missions. We're not taking Jesus to the Navajo Reservation. He's already there. We're going to serve and to learn because we don't know how to love them well. And we're going to let them teach us. And that'll change everything. And I'm excited to do that with some of these guys. So I thought we'd look at some pictures and tell some stories. So if you don't mind, I'm going to relax a little bit. And here we go. There. So this is the area we're going. It's about an 8-hour drive if we don't stop to pee. I can say that kind of stuff with you guys, and you're the kind of group that you're supposed to smile, but a lot of groups don't, and only half of you did. So help me here. Come on. Some churches I get kicked out of when I say things like, so I don't say those things to them. Navajo Reservation is the largest Indian reservation in North America. It's about 27,000 square miles. It is huge. The Hopi Reservation is inside it, surrounded by the Navajo Reservation. And it's in the Four Corners area, as you can see, a little tiny bit in Colorado, which you can't see very well. We're going to be staying in the New Mexico Four Corners area, probably go over the border to Arizona, maybe go up to Utah, I don't know for sure yet, but at least Arizona and New Mexico and Colorado. About 300,000 Navajo live there, and get this, 75% of them are under 25. That's huge. Only about 15,000 follow Jesus. The primary religion of the Navajo is witchcraft, but there's been a really crazy combination for about the last 100 years, as evangelical Christians have been going in to evangelize and to disciple, been a crazy combination because they talk about Jesus, but so do the Mormons. And then you've got the Baptist flavor, and then you've got the Methodist flavor, and then you've got the Assembly of God flavor, and you got everybody's flavor, right? But very rarely in indigenous groups all over the world, very rarely do we want to let go of our other gods. And you and I know that too, don't we? When Jesus says, I want it all, we go, I got to go. Because it's scary. Is what it is. It's scary. But I'm more familiar with all of this stuff. I'll take you and, right? Jesus, I'll take you and. And that's a lot of what's happened on the Navajo Reservation. So the primary religion is witchcraft. So you've got your witchcraft. And then along with witchcraft, part of what you do is you smoke stuff, which makes witchcraft even more interesting, you could say. And then if you throw in a little bit of Baptist flavor and a little bit of Methodist flavor and a little bit of Assembly of God flavor and a little bit of New Hope Christian Church flavor and a little bit of this and a little bit of that and the Mormons too, and you don't let go of anything else to choose Jesus and only Jesus, you got a problem. And that's what we've got, is a big, big problem. So about in over 100 years, about only 15,000, about 5%, have accepted Jesus as their Savior and are actively growing as Christians. Those are horrible statistics. Horrible after 100 years of evangelization. And I'll explain that a little more later, why it happens that way. But all that to say, we've got our work cut out for us. And what is our work? To love people, serve people, help people, give to people. We'll talk more about that too. It's okay, kid. You're good. So when I go down, a lot of times we have to take a U-Haul. And the reason we take a U-Haul is because of a newsletter I read 7 years ago. The mission that we work with sends out newsletters several times a year, and one of them had this one line that just got me forever. The statement was, actually it was in the form of a question, what is the biggest need on the Navajo reservation? And I have been down so many times, my brain immediately started filtering through all these things that I know are huge needs, and the next line said, Bibles, and that wasn't on my list. And that's the crux of my ministry. It's what I do, is teach the word and provide the word, give the word, all of that. But that wasn't on my list because it's not an obvious need. And then the newsletter went on to explain. There is a Walmart 20 minutes away from the border of the reservation, and you can buy a Bible for a couple of bucks, no problem at all. But if you have your choice between buying a loaf of bread for your kid so your kid can eat tonight, and a Bible, what are you going to buy? Loaf of bread every time. Absolutely. Absolutely. And so when you do ministry, you need the heart of God to do that. And I don't mean just loving people, but the Bible says that his words are the overflow of his heart. To have his word is to have his heart. To have his word is to have what he thinks about and what he talks about and what he feels and what his decisions are. And if you don't have his word, then you are missing this huge part of who he is. You can't separate God from his word. So they need his word, and they need it desperately. But English isn't their first language. So if you go down to the local Christian bookstore in the nearby town and you buy a Navajo Bible, it's going to cost $79. Who's got that? Not the Navajo. So there's a big problem. And when I read the question, what's the biggest need? And I saw the answer, Bibles. I heard Holy Spirit's voice probably more clearly than I've ever heard in my life. And he said this, what can you do? He did not say, well, what can you do? And he didn't say, well, what can you do? He said, what can you do? And out loud, I responded. I was sitting there in my kitchen by myself, and out loud I said, we can provide all the Bibles that Many Waters Mission needs and the 25 churches that they work with. We can provide all of the Bibles that all of those churches will need for every outreach, for everybody who meets Jesus, for every person in their church who needs one. We can do it in Navajo and in English, and we can provide every pastor with a personal library because they don't even have electricity in most of the parts, much less a computer. We can do that. I can do that. I know enough people that I can do that. And so now I know you. And for the last, 7 years it's been, I think, I've been taking down Bibles. U-Haul's full of Bibles. We've taken down over 6,500 so far. We've provided all 25 pastors that we work with personal libraries, as well as every single Bible that they need and have needed and will ever need for all the outreaches that they do, evangelistic or just their church meetings. And so we get to participate in that. What kinds of Bibles? You can go to thrift stores, you can go to garage sales, you can clean out grandma's basement, you can maybe look on your own bookshelf because you got that Bible for Mother's Day that you haven't looked at since Mother's Day, and you got the couple's Bible that you haven't looked at since you've been a couple, and you've got that, you know, and the list goes on. You know what I'm talking about, because the average Christian evangelical home has 9 Bibles in it in the U.S. Do you know that? 9 Bibles. We're not reading them all. Statistically, we know that between 2 and 5% of evangelical Christians in America are reading their Bibles every day for the sake of personal relationship and growth with Jesus. 2 to 5%. That means for every 100 people sitting in church, 2 to 5 of them are reading their Bibles every day for the purpose of growth. Not good stats, not good, but we've got an average of 9 Bibles sitting at home somewhere. Do I need to keep explaining, or have you got the, yeah, okay. So maybe those Bibles you haven't read, but here's the deal. New or nearly new, got it? New or nearly new. Would you want a new Bible? Excuse me. Would you want somebody to give you a Bible that the zipper is broken or the spine is broken or the cover's ripped off or pages are torn out or it's all marked up or some 3-year-old colored in it? Would you want a Bible like that? Then don't give a Bible like that. Yeah? And you'd be amazed at library book sales and at hospital book sales and at garage sales and at thrift stores and all that. You would be amazed how many new or nearly new Bibles are there for about $1 a piece. Yeah? Go get them. Okay? Go find them. Go to the garage sales in your neighborhood. Go to the thrift store in your neighborhood, but go get them. And bring them back here, and we'll go through them. We'll clean them up. We'll do whatever, and box them up and take them down there. Deal? Oh, good. Three of you with me are doing that. That wasn't very convincing. Hopefully in the next 30 minutes, I'll convince you a little bit more. So why do we do this, and how do we do this? You know, the Navajo don't trust the white man, and for good reason. You understand that, right? Yeah? And in any relationship, Navajo or not, in any relationship, one of the most key components of a healthy relationship is trust. Trust takes the longest to develop, but it's also the most fragile and easily broken, right? And then you have to redevelop again. So that's what's been happening on the Navajo reservation ever since we moved in, basically. And that is a little bit of trust, broken. Little bit of trust, broken. Broken, broken, broken. So even the Navajo Christians will say this to you. We forgive, but we're not going to let our children forget. Which arguably is not necessarily the Christian approach. However, it's still a legitimate thing that God works through relationships. Jesus came for people. He works in the context of relationships. That's why he calls us a family. The body of Christ, right? A family. He calls us brothers and sisters. He calls himself Father. Jesus is the Son. The whole kingdom is built in the context of family with the same verbiage. And so trust takes a while to develop. Relationships, trust is key in relationships. So we never, ever, ever go down to the reservation by ourselves or thinking that we can go in independently. That's just dumb. You go in and come alongside people who already have trust, who are down there all the time. And that's what we'll be doing. All that we do is in the context of relationship. And like I said, I've already been going for 19 years. So I've got a lot of trust developed with people too. But I don't live there. I don't live there. I actually tried once because I really like it down there. And the Lord said, I didn't tell you to live here. What are you doing looking at houses? Ding dong, go back to Colorado. So I did. So this is the mission, Many Waters Mission. It's in Waterflow, New Mexico. Waterflow is about this big, the whole town, about that big. And a lot of dogs, and they run loose, and I carry a stick. This mission used to be a Catholic convent and school. The part on the right side is an addition, obviously. That's where we'll be staying, but the whole mission is used. It is old, it is dirty, it has fallen apart, and it is stinky. Welcome home, at least for a week. It's a challenge. Why is it a challenge? Because the people who run this place, I'll tell you more about them in a second, they believe with all their hearts that God has asked them not to, I don't know the right word to use, not to charge, not to ask people, will you donate this much or will you give when you come? We just want you to serve. So all of the teams that come, they want to go out into the reservation. They want to hang out with the Navajo Christians. They want to minister there. They want to do what they can. But literally, no teams ever go to help in the mission itself, but they're all staying there. And they don't give to help pay for the water and the electricity and all of that stuff. And can I just say, that's not honorable. And the kingdom we live in, it's a kingdom of honor. Ours is a culture of honor. So every team I've ever taken down, we pay per person, per night to contribute, not just to pay for what we used, but to help the next guy too. We pay it forward too. But also, we don't serve exclusively on the reservation. In fact, not a lot. We do some, and we'll definitely meet people and definitely serve, but my call, the call of God on my life is to come alongside pastors and missionaries. And these guys need people to come alongside them. So we'll spend some significant time cleaning and repairing stuff, maybe putting in a new door or a new screen or a new drawer somewhere or fixing a window or part of a roof. Or it doesn't matter. Playing with the kids who live there, it doesn't matter what we do just so we serve, right? Even Jesus, Mark chapter 10, even Jesus said, I didn't come to be served. I'm the Son of God. I didn't come to be served. I came to serve and to give my life. And that's what we're going to go do. Serve and give our lives. for a week to these people. So they have a lot of outbuildings. They have animals there. It's like I said, it's dirty. It's not kept up really well. We'll do our best. My ministry is called Get the Word Out. And Get the Word Out, we have a saying. We have an honor code. We have, I don't know exactly what to call it, but it's this. Always, every place you are, leave it better than when you arrived. Always leave a place better than when you came. And it's not just trips. That's my personal motto when I use your bathroom here. If there's a paper towel on the floor, I pick it up. There's some junk laying out, clean it up. It's my personal honor code, but it's also the honor code of my ministry. Leave a place better than we found it. So that's what we will be doing. And if that's all we do, then I've completed the good work that God's given me to do. Come alongside pastors and missionaries and leave a place better than I find it. Body, soul, and spirit. That's what we do. So you guys who are on the team, hope you heard that one. That's what we're doing. All right, the founder of this Many Waters Mission is there on the right. Her name is Lynn Cartwright. She and her husband Don moved to the reservation with their family in 1979. What a story. Miracles, but what trust they learned in the Lord. For a couple of years, they lived on a mountainside about 8,000 feet altitude in a bus with no running water, no electricity in the bus, raising four kids, no less. Really have paid the price to serve and love these people. And the people have watched for 35 years now and have seen it. Yeah, they love us. They love us. And so trust has developed. So these are the guys we come alongside. Laverne is there on the left. She's a very short woman from Texas, and boy, does she talk like it. She and her husband, Ricky, live in Texas for 6 months out of the year, and they come to the reservation for 6 months and serve there. Precious, precious people. And they have their own set of miracle stories, but we will be working primarily with Laverne and her husband, Ricky, while we're there. Next picture's of Laverne as well. I love this woman. She is just full of life. Great Bible teacher, my goodness. But she loves these people. And this woman knows how to pray. And you know how I told you, Lord, send me to places who have the message you've given me, the way you've given it to me, who can receive it that way, but also places where I need them. I need this woman in my life. She teaches me so much about trusting God, about how to pray. Her story is amazing. It's just miraculous. I need these kinds of people in my life. So she's just a dear friend. We will be planning the trip together and then making it happen. Wow, I just caught a glimpse of that. That's a large me. Be very thankful that I'm not really that big, okay? That would be scary. The next picture is of Shiprock. Shiprock is one of the holy mountains for the Navajo people. They call it Rock with Wings. If you can't see it clearly on this picture, but off to the left are lower rock formations. This mountain is huge. And so the lower rock formations on the left and all the way to the right as well are also big. You just can't see them there. Let me give you an idea of how big. If you drive all the way around that rock formation, to the left, to the right, and around Shiprock, it's about 100 miles. It is a huge area, really big. And it's beautiful, absolutely beautiful. The Navajo call it Rock with Wings, and they believe that this rock carried the first Navajo clans down from the north. So it's a very holy place for them. Here's one of the things I've learned in missions. This honor thing we've been talking about, it's a big, big deal. If it's holy to them, does that mean it's holy to me? No. But if it's holy to them, does that mean I respect them? Yes. So a lot of people go in and they'll go near the mountain, they'll go to the mountain, they'll climb the mountain, they'll do rappelling and rock climbing and all of that. It's so offensive. It is so offensive. It doesn't have anything to do with belief system. It's honor to say, hey, if you call it holy, then why would I offend you? Why would I do that? So when we go into somebody else's culture, and it's what I do for a living, you know, about every week I go to another culture. And when we go into somebody else's culture, man, we eat what they eat, and we live the way they live, and we help them as best we can in the context of their culture. That's just being nice, much less Christian, isn't it? Isn't it just nice? to do that. Jesus did it. Love it. I think it's Acts 10:38, I think, that says Jesus went around doing good. There you go. If that's all we did, world would be a little better place, wouldn't it? Jesus, it says, was anointed by God, and he went around doing good. Being nice to people. Healing people besides. Stuff like that. And the same spirit that lives in him lives in us. So, there are some interesting places on the reservation. This is certainly one of them. I travel all over the world, and I take pictures of what I think are very funny signs. This is a very funny sign. Not because of what it says. It's because of where it is. That is one of the largest porn stores I have ever seen in my life, the one on the right. And it's got... So the Catholics went in and bought this billboard, and it is freaking huge, this billboard. It is enormous, and it's right next to the porn shop, and it says, Jesus is watching you. And so I think it's hysterical. I had to pull off to the side of the road the first time I saw it because I was laughing so hard I couldn't drive, but also to take the picture. And then I wanted to take it from the other side too. I wanted to take the shot from the other side. But when I did flip to you and started coming back on this highway, the sign on the other side, I didn't think there would be one. I just needed to turn around and go back home, you know? The sign on the other side says, Jesus is still watching you. Oh, it's like, go Catholics, yeah. So one of the reasons I wanted to draw your attention here is because the root of a lot of the problems on the Navajo Reservation and in Denver and in my house and yours, how do I say this? It's lack. The root of a lot of our problems are lack. That's why it's such a big deal that Jesus said, I'm your good shepherd, and shepherd takes care of his sheep, and you're gonna lack nothing if you follow me, because I'm taking you on into my family here.
Amen.
Yeah? So poverty is a nasty, nasty, horrible, painful thing. And all kinds of problems come out of poverty. All kinds of problems. Just about every kind of problem comes out of poverty. Addictions, domestic violence. On the Indian reservations, they have the highest statistics in the United States of teen pregnancy, of domestic violence, of a school dropout rate, of unemployment. All of these things, the stats are the highest on the Indian reservations than any other place in the U.S. When you don't have enough money to eat, you buy what you can eat, and what you can afford is usually food that's not good for you at all. So bad diet makes bad health. And because of the kinds of things that they eat, let me tell you what their primary diet is here. Fry bread, so deep fried, just white flour and water, basically. Fry bread, potatoes, beans, and sheep meat, which is mutton is very, very, very greasy. And that's primarily what they eat. So you eat that bad, and you eat that way for long enough, and the first thing you get is diabetes. And the first thing that goes when you have diabetes is your eyesight. So almost all the people on the reservation don't see well at all. And the older you get, the more you eat like that, the more you lose your eyesight. Lots of blindness. Lots and lots and lots of blindness down there. Because of that, the Bibles that we ask you to get or to donate toward are giant print Bibles, not to be confused with large print Bibles. Have you ever looked at the inside a Bible where it says large print on the cover and the packaging? Yeah, you and your magnifying glass. I mean, it's like eight font, size 8 or 9, something like that, and they call it large. I can't see it. I don't know, but of course I'm old and I wear trifocals, but still, I can't see it. I don't have diabetes and I'm not blind, but we need to get giant print Bibles. Most of the people start to lose their eyesight and start to gain the weight, and diabetes sets in at about 14 years old. Yeah. And it doesn't mean they're blind at 14. It means that's when everything starts to break down. They keep it as long as they can. But more and more, what we're doing is more sedentary activity as well. We sit more. We're on our screens and our phones and everything more. We're just doing less and less activity. And the way the reservation is set up, they're farming less and less, and they've got fewer and fewer animals. And we've just, can I say it this way? We've just screwed them over in a lot of different ways. Average income is about, per family, is about $7,200 a year. We've got a problem. We've got a problem, and they need help. So Jesus went around doing good. Pretty sure that's what we're supposed to do, and help take care of people. So addictions, domestic violence, here's the cycle that happens. I can't find a job. I'm the head of my household. I can't find a job, so I get depressed because I can't take care of my family, right? Of course. And then I start to feel guilty because I'm depressed and not taking care of my family. And so I start drinking. And then I realize, well, this isn't going to help at all. So I move away from home and go to a city where I can find a job. I get a job there. And then I start missing my family so terribly and missing home so bad that I quit my job there and come back home with the money. And then we spend all the money and we eat all of the money. And then I can't find a job. And so I start feeling guilty. And then I get depressed. And then I start drinking again. And then I realize, well, this isn't going to work. So I go back and I get in it. And it goes on and on with family after family after family. A lot of reasons for that. A lot of things we could talk about that we're not going to talk about. But when God said to me, what can you do? The answer comes in something I learned in Mercy Ships, when I worked with Mercy Ships years and years ago. We called it two hands of the gospel. I can help you practically, can help you physically, I can help you temporarily. I can give you food, I can give you some clothing, I can encourage you, I can do a lot of stuff like that, and I can also tell you the truth. I can help you temporarily and I can help you eternally. Tell you about Jesus. But listen, if you try to get somebody who's hungry to take a Bible, they'll shake that Bible in your face and say, I can't eat your Bible. If you're hungry enough, you don't have ears to hear anyway. If you can't even see, if you can't find a job, if you can't take care of your family, life is not happy. So why not help? So that's what we're going to do. We're going to go help. We're going to go love, serve, give, and take both hands of the gospel. Tell them about Jesus too, because we do it in his name, right? Right? That's what we do. We do it in his name. Colossians 3, 16 and 17. Whatever you do, whether you eat, whether you drink, whatever you do, whatever you say, do it all in the name of, as a representative of the Lord Jesus Christ. And give thanks to God while you do it. In other words, be happy. Be thankful while you do it. So these will be some of the challenges that we're faced with. This is my friend Betty. I think Betty's got three teeth left, if I remember right. She is sweet and adorable. She's married to Pastor Paul, and they live in a house that's, how big is it? Maybe two of these drum shells, maybe, with a couple of their grandkids and themselves. Maybe like the width here. Jing, 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 right about there. Live in a house like that and pastor a church of precious, precious people. And they just serve and they love people. They play guitar and sing. And Betty was teaching me this day how to make fry bread. Betty was not impressed with my culinary expertise. Let's just say it had a lot of holes and it didn't help at all when I dropped the dough on the floor. Did not make Betty happy, especially when I said, I'll just cook it, it's all right. Burn the germs out of it. It's deep fry fat anyway, it's all right. I didn't say it like that, okay? I didn't say it like that. But that's what I was thinking. She was not happy. She did not smile at me with all three teeth. She didn't do it. But she is precious, and I really hope you guys who are going on this trip, I hope you get to meet Paul and Betty. These guys, their story is unbelievable. The miraculous way they met Jesus with their whole family when they were growing up. And this is her husband, Paul. He is a precious man, loves Jesus, and got a great story. Paul is holding a proclaimer right there, because we don't just take down hard copy Bibles, but we, A lot of people are not just blind and can't read a Bible, but they start to lose their hearing as well. So this is an audio Bible. It's dedicated. Everything that's on here, you can't take off and you can't add to it. You can't put anything else on it. It's only the Bible. It's got a solar panel on the back. And if the battery is shot, then it's got a crank on the side to charge the battery. So you can use it anywhere, anytime. You can change verse and chapter and book very easily. It plays really loud. It without distorting, about 300 people can hear it outdoors. So it gets quite loud with the quality of the speaker that's in there, but they're also quite expensive. Get the Word Out has provided one for every church for them to distribute and use as needed and to loan to people at various times or to use in outdoor meetings, but also bought some extra ones for other people. But they're about $80 a piece, and that adds up pretty quick, especially when you've got that many blind people. So now what we've started providing, and this is actually better. This is a Mega Voice player, and it has English and Navajo on here. Is very easily, you can toggle back and forth from English to Navajo easily. The Bible is on there in Navajo, spoken by a first language Navajo speaker, of course. And again, a real good quality speaker, a solar panel on the back of it, and batteries on the inside. But the other cool thing is, you can get about 500 hours on this thing, which means that there are Navajo songs, worship songs in Navajo, Navajo pastors teaching, good solid Bible teaching, and they cost about 30 a piece. So we've been giving a lot of these, because they're easy for the people to take, to carry around with the little buttons that you push. It's very easy, straightforward to understand. They can feel their way around there. And so this is what we've been doing lately. Here's another thing we've been doing. Somebody donated these, again, solar panel in the back. You know, a lot of people, the people who live on the reservation, they don't have electricity and running water and stuff. So the solar panels are really cool. They do have sun. Boy, oh boy, do they have sun. But this is a dedicated thing as well. You can only pick up one radio station with this. That's it. And it's the Navajo Christian radio station. But you can get it. And a lot of people, because there's so little written in Navajo and there's so little available in the Navajo language, people who will listen to just about anything if it's in their language. They'll read just about anything if it's in their language. All people all over the world. So this is a really, really cool little gadget. And they've got boxes and boxes of those. Yeah, let's keep going here. What have we got next? Oh, me. We do a lot of construction when we go, for a lot of different reasons. It's a very practical way to say we care, so does God. This guy's house in particular, just to give you a bit of a typical story, I'll put it like that. The guy who owned this house, his name is Jackson. The house is about 500 square feet or so, 400, 500. He lived there with his grandson, I believe, or his son, I can't remember which, who was an alcoholic. And it wasn't in good shape. When we went to spend a week working on Jackson's house, every window was broken. One door was gone. The other door was broken. The stove was broken. There was no electricity, no running water, and obviously some outside things as well. His drunk son would come home and kick in the walls. On the outside is stucco. On the inside is drywall. What we discovered with the holes that we were trying to repair is surely there's some insulation there, right? Surely as hot and as cold as it gets. Nope. What was between the stucco and the drywall? Chicken wire. And what was stuck between the holes in the chicken wire were empty shotgun shell boxes. That's it. Cold place. Hot place. Not good. Who wants to live in a place like that? So we did everything we could. We worked for a week, about eight of us, I guess, worked for a week on his place. It's only about 100 yards off of the main highway. It's really close. It's not like it's in some remote part of the reservation. It's right there. It's 20 minutes from Walmart, for heaven's sakes. What can you do? What can you do? So the construction needs are huge, both at the mission and outside the mission. I do know that we're arranging to work on the home of one parishioner for one of the churches, and we'll work on the mission base as well. So another way that you can help is to give money. You know, I was teaching, it was interesting, I was teaching in a mission base probably 2 months ago now, and they were just getting ready to send this team of 30 young adults out on outreach to, where were they going? I think it was Eastern Europe. And they were having prayer meetings all the time and believing God for the money to send these guys on outreach, right? We're people of faith and we're people of prayer and we're gonna believe God for this money. And they were just, they were enthusiastic young people with this this idea. And while they were enthusiastic and while they had this idea and while they were praying, they're all sitting at their desks with a Starbucks, cup of Starbucks there in it. We started adding up how much was right there. And I said, yeah, you're praying and you want God to provide, but you don't want to be the answer to your prayer. What are you doing? Amen. Anybody willing? Anybody in this class? What, that's when you lose eye contact. You start saying things like that, people go. So the whole class went, except for the people who needed the money. They're going. So I said, you know, what would happen if, and we've all heard the scenario, what would happen if you gave up this, or if you sold that on eBay, or if you had a garage sale with your neighbor or something, and you got rid of stuff that you don't need anyway and haven't used or looked at for a long time. But what about something that you do enjoy? That's the whole Romans 12 living sacrifice piece, isn't it? Offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable unto God. This is your reasonable service of worship unto God. That's what the Bible says. And so there's this living sacrifice piece that we need to understand as well. And so that's part of the challenge. What can you do? It's not, well, what can I do? Remember? It's, what can you do? And we can all do something. Seriously, we can all do something. Whether it's finances or whether it's this stuff. You'll be talking about this more later, but there's an insert in your bulletin that has a list, and also in these signs, that has a list of all the stuff we're taking down and hygiene items. Can I just say, at one point, I wish I would have had a video of this, and I didn't, but I can demo a little bit. We gave a Navajo Bible in the Navajo language to a woman who was about 72, and she had never owned the whole Bible in Navajo before, but she'd known Jesus for about 30 years. Teaching in her church, didn't have a Bible in her own language. Didn't have a Bible in her own language. I gave her a Bible, and literally, I've never seen anything like it before. She took it like this, and she went, oh, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus. And she just started dancing, tears pouring down her face, pouring down her face. Thank you so much. She danced all over that warehouse. I haven't seen, 72 years old, haven't seen anything like it before. But the same kind of response is what we give when we give people a bar of soap. Only it's more like, man, thanks. I can give my baby a bath. Thank you. Thank you. Tears. Praise God for the dollar store. Yeah. We can do something. What can you do? And it doesn't have to be these little trial sizes. I mean, bless the people. Sheesh, give them the size you buy for yourself. Said that out loud, didn't I? It's kind of the do to others thing. Do to others as you want them to do to you. Not do to others before they do it unto you. Do to others like you would want to have done to you. It's one of those gigs. Where are we now? Bessie. Bessie is so sweet. I've lost track of how old she is, and I'm pretty sure she has too. She's in her 90s somewhere. And you know, I'm not the tallest thing in the world, but Bessie comes up to about here on me. She's this little, tiny, sweet lady, very well educated, fully bilingual, Navajo and English, phenomenal translator. Her weaving is gorgeous. Okay, what can you do? You know what Bessie does? She buys yarn, sells something that she's got. She lives in a little tiny house, sells something that she's got, buys the yarn, makes the rugs, sells them for about a fourth as much as they cost in the store, and uses that money to buy food for people who are hungry on the Navajo reservation. I know. When you're with Bessie, you don't want to do anything because you can't. I mean, the conviction and the grace and the love is, I just sit there and just, Bessie, I want to be like you when I grow up. I hope I grow up. I really do. But Bessie, one day, I was talking to her and she said, let me tell you a story about Jesus. Bessie, first of all, is not afraid of anybody, nobody. I've seen her go up to a great big huge guy 40 times bigger than her who's holding a gun and drunk. And she just said, son, you need Jesus. You need Jesus. Now sit down here and let me pray for you. And he does. It's the weirdest thing. Everybody calls her Grandma Bessie. They know she loves them. But they don't give her any crap, I tell you. We do what Grandma Bessie says. And if she says she's going to pray for me, then I'm going to let her pray for me. She's not afraid of anybody, nobody. So one day she said, you know, let me tell you a story about Jesus. The other day, and she said, she hits you, this happens so many times, not just once, so many times. There's a knock on my door, and I go over to the door and open the door, and somebody says, Grandma Bessie, I haven't eaten for 3 days. Do you have any food? She said, oh, I've got some food. So I invite them in, I make them sit down, and I pray for them. And then I give them all the food in my house. That's when she got me. You give them all the food in your house? Well, yeah, they haven't eaten, and I just had lunch today, so I give them all the food in my house. Okay. She said, they thank me and they leave, and sometimes I hear from them again, sometimes I don't. But they were hungry. So when I close the door, I say, Father, I don't have any food to eat tonight. You need to provide that for me. And she said, you know, almost every time before I go to bed that night, somebody knocks on my door and says, Bessie, you know, I was praying for you today and I just felt like I needed to bring you over some food. So here's some food. She said, almost every time it happens before I go to bed, but sometimes he waits till breakfast in the morning and I go without dinner. But that's okay, because that guy didn't eat for 3 days. Would you do that? I mean, seriously, if somebody says to me, I'm hungry, I'd take them out for a meal, or I'd give them a gift card, or I might have them over. But give them all the food in my house? Really? So I hope for Bessie's sake, no, I hope for our sake that Bessie's still alive. Bessie said to me one day, she said, when I woke up this morning, I was so disappointed that I wasn't in heaven. She said, every morning I just want to, I go to bed at night and I think, I hope when I wake up I'm in heaven. But I'm still here, so what does Jesus want us to do today? So for our sake, I hope Bessie's still alive. For Bessie's sake, honestly, I hope she's with Jesus. What's next here? We do a lot of Bible studies. Like I said, the Word of God is so key because it's the truth. And Jesus said the truth is the only thing that's going to set us free, right? So we need to do a lot of word study. Unfortunately, with the combination of teachers and churches and, can I say it this way, missionary rejects that have been sent down there, a lot of what they have is law. They teach Old Testament mostly. They don't teach grace. They don't hear grace. Pretty much what they hear is, and I know we wouldn't really say it this way, but this is the message. You need to sing the songs like we sing the songs. You need to dress like we dress. You need to act like we act, and you need to change your behavior. It's this kind of a deal. And so what's the only logical interpretation? Christianity is the white man's religion. And it's not. It's so not. I mean, look around the room. Yeah? Christianity is not the white man's religion, but that's what they've been hearing because of the way they've been treated for so long. And you know what? We just need to change these things. We need to change these things by loving people and contextualizing this and meeting them where they are and being people of honor and people of love, people of provision, regardless. People who look them in the eye and don't just look at people, but see people. You need to see people, yeah? When I was in Mercy Ships, I just got another newsletter this week from Mercy Ships. Mercy Ships are a fleet of hospital boats that go to the poorest nations in the world to give state-of-the-art hospital care for people, medical care. And they have a new record as of last month. They took the largest tumor ever off of this guy's head, basically, and they had a picture of him before and after. They removed a 16-pound tumor. It was like this, started right here and just grew out this way. And the surgeon removed a 16-pound tumor, then an after picture of this guy. Of course, he doesn't look totally normal, but my goodness, the tumor's gone. The tumor is gone now. And it wasn't malignant, of course, or they couldn't have done surgery. But one thing I learned with Mercy Ships is look in their eyes and you won't see. Look in their eyes and you'll see who you can connect with, because there's no difference between you and them. If you look at any other part at all, our brains are going to get led astray. They're going to go a different direction. Our emotions or our hormones or whatever are going to go a different direction. But if you look in somebody's eyes and you start seeing what Jesus sees, now we've got a good start with loving people. Let's start seeing people, church. Stop just looking at people, okay? Deal?
Deal.
Yeah? That was fewer of you. I'm down to two. All right, so we need the word. This is a random picture. I really like this place because this is the hogan. The hogan is the traditional Navajo home. This is the hogan where they translated the whole Bible into the Navajo language for these people. All happened right there in about 3 years' time in that little place, and I just wanted to see it. So I took a picture, and now you get to see it too. What's next? These are the Bibles that we take down. Like I said, the Bibles that you can buy in the bookstore, about $79. We get these. Where are my notes? We get these for hardcover Navajo Bibles, Old and New Testament, for about $25. Giant print New Testaments for $16. Giant print hardcover, not softcover. So we can do that. What can you do? Yeah, we can do this. And we can provide some of these. When you start seeing, and with other stories that I'll tell you here, when you start seeing the people's responses, it's just amazing. Remember what I said? They have so little already written in their language that when they do get something, they'll read it. It doesn't matter what it is. Yeah. It's one of the interlinear Bible. Actually, Preston, could I get you to run out to my table out there and get the black Bible? You can tell that it's in Navajo. It's black. It's kind of by the map. Thank you. There's an interlinear Bible that's so interesting. There's a copy of it out there that you can look at after the service. It's the Navajo Bible, line by line, word by word, and directly under it is the English transliteration. So what it says literally, word for word, in English, when you compare the two languages, makes no sense whatsoever to English speakers. No sense. And the Navajo look at it and go, oh, I get it. I understand now. Because they see their language right with the English, and they've heard so much of both. It just totally makes sense to them. Their lights go on. So they get this. This book is the primary teaching tool for English and Navajo classes. English as a second language and Navajo as a second language. The Bible, because it's interlinear, because you've got them both right there and it makes sense to them. Let me give you an example. I'll just open someplace random here. Matthew chapter 45, and it says, has all of the Navajo words. And here's the English transliteration. Was noon from three times hour, whole thing was darkness, and the three at maybe hour, Jesus and sharply with loud voice says, Eli, Eli. And they go, ah, I get it. And I go, ah, good, take it. So, this is New Testament only, interlinear. They're about they're $20 a piece, and this is the one of the translations that happened in that hogan as well. So, just, man, cool stories, cool people. But those are the ones that we buy. So these are some of the 6,500 volumes that we've taken down. We've provided every pastor, the 25 churches that we work with, 25-ish churches, every pastor with a personal library, commentaries, concordances. You know, they hardly have electricity. They're not going to have a computer where they can just Google whatever they need for their sermon study. They need hard copies of stuff. And they can't be a high academic level. They need to be something that's understandable for them. So we've been very selective about what we take down. But they have had, since we started doing this, since the very first trip we made, they have never lacked Bibles. They have never lacked everything they needed for every outreach, every church, and every pastor. Never. And I intend for that to keep happening. Will you help me?
Yes.
Yeah? We can do this. We can do this. By the way, let me be more specific about the kinds of Bibles we need. Giant print, not to be confused with large print. Teen Bibles, great. Teen Bible, on the front, it will say Teen Bible. If it says Student Bible, that doesn't mean Teen Bible. That means Study Bible. Student Bible means Study Bible. You're going to be a student of the Word, you're going to study it. Does not mean teen. If it's going to be a Teen Bible, it needs to say Teen Bible on it. Okay? Did that make sense? Yeah, okay. Thank you. And then children's Bibles. Children's Bibles, children's Bible storybooks. But repeat after me, no King James Bibles.
No King James Bibles.
Totally didn't convince me. No King James Bibles. How many of you are with me and you don't even understand it? If English is your second language, do you think they're going to understand it? Not going to happen. A lot of the Bibles we find in thrift stores or garage sales are King James Bibles, or the giant print ones that, you know, the family Bible that nobody's ever opened. You know those kind? They weigh about 300 pounds and they're about that thick. They're King James. Let's not go there, all right? Just don't. I will not take them. So you'll be wasting your time and your money and certainly mine. So let's not go there, all right? Giant print children's. Why children's? By the time you have the poor eyesight and you have English as a second language and your kids are going to school and your grandkids are going to school and you're starting to lose your hearing and everything else, what's the family thing to do? Get the little ones to read to the older ones, right? So this is a huge way for them to practice English, which they need for school as well as Navajo. But more importantly than that, these guys are a storytelling culture. They love story. Way more than we love story. Their whole tradition is passed down through story. So they tell their stories, and do any of you besides me get irritated that your Bible doesn't have pictures in it? I want pictures. If you get children's Bibles with pictures and large print in a story form, that's a win-win for those guys. So the older people will come to the tables and they'll say, do you have any books for my granddaughter? I'll say, yeah, look at these children's Bibles and children's storybooks right here. They say, oh, thank you. That's so great. But they're really getting them for themselves. And that's fine. If they'll read them, we always ask, will you read it? Yeah, well then here, Merry Christmas. And just give it to them. Just take them. They say, how much? No. Take it. No, really. We want it. No, take it. It's okay. It's okay. So, very quickly. Oh, Jeff, I have a confession to make. You know how you told me 10:30 first service, 12:15 second service? Yeah. My brain automatically translated that to 12:45 second service, and I just now remembered. Will you forgive me? Because if you don't, I know they're not going to. I am so sorry. Honestly, I've been shooting for 12:45 going, I'm doing pretty good here. And it's 12:35. I am so sorry. So you want me to finish two really quick stories? Or you can boo me off stage. It's fine. That happens to me in Sweden. It's a weird thing to be called a heretic in another country. But anyway, these guys were, there's a food line about a third of a mile back from the mission. The line was that long. Then they heard there was a Bible table with free Bibles. People were getting out of the food lines, coming into the Bible line. This is the Bible line. Coming out of the food lines into the Bible line saying, we'd really like a Bible. What kind of Bibles do you have? And we have every color and every version and size and all kinds of stuff. They just love it. We give Bibles away at the flea market, and we don't have to pay booth rental because we're not making any money. Every time I've done this, people come for prayer. They just ask. Oh, we put a little sign out if you want prayer for anything, and there are always people there, asking for prayer, taking Bibles. Ding. This is another guy who got his first Bible in his language. Large print, giant print. We fixed all kinds of things in his house, gave him a couple of boxes of food, handed him a Bible, and he took the Bible and said, "Now I've got what I want. Time for you to leave." And it was fine to do all the work at his house, but what he really wanted, first time he had ever had a Bible, known Jesus for 30 years, first time he's ever had a Bible in his own language. Why? This is inexcusable. It's inexcusable. Happy pastor, happy camper. A study Bible for the first time ever, a pastor has a study Bible. That cannot be, you guys. This is not right. But it was new, it was nice, big print, he was happy. This is a roadside Bible giveaway. We parked out in the middle of nowhere, had a few things to eat. It was at Christmas time, put on some Christmas music, had some hot chocolate and some popcorn and stuff out there, and tables full of Bibles. And literally, an hour later, there was a traffic jam out in the middle of nowhere. People heard we had Bibles. A line out in the middle of a field, nowhere. They're hungry for the word, and we can give it to them. Let's. Okay? That's Betty again. Grass withers, the flowers fall, but the word of the Lord stands forever. We can give them something to eat. We can give them a comfortable house, and we should. But the word of the Lord stands forever. Not a loaf of bread. Sometimes it's the loaf of bread that gets them to the place where they can hear the word, though. Two hands of the gospel, yeah? Yeah? So, Lord Jesus, we need you. We need you to ask us the question, very personally, what can you do? And we will answer one way or the other. Even if we don't answer, that's answering. Lord, not in guilt, not in condemnation, not in fear, not in shoulds, I should do this, or I've got to do this. Not in guilt, no, you don't do that. But what you do, Lord, is you convict us. So we ask for your conviction, and we will respond. May we hear the voice of the Lord today say, what can you do? And may we respond according to your word, in Jesus' name, amen.
Stuff that you can donate. I want to encourage you to pray and say, Lord, what can I do? What are some of these items I could do? And if you could get items in bulk, you don't necessarily have to get all the items, but if you could get, like, you know, 20 or 30 shampoos, and something we realized is when you go on Amazon, like if you go to the store, you know, you might be getting 5-6 for $20, you know, of decent sized shampoos or whatever. But if you go on Amazon, you can order like 20 or 30 of them. You can get sweet prices. So if you plan ahead and work ahead, you can donate a lot of stuff for a lot less money, or for the same amount of money, a lot more stuff, and we can make a great impact. And then you can also, the Bibles that she talked about, and then at the bottom also money. You can donate money not only to help in getting Bibles, but also to help us in fixing things around there that might need fixed. If we need to buy a door or some windows or different things like that, you can donate money there as well for that. You can drop money off for any of that kind of stuff at the Welcome Center out in the foyer. And we're going to be doing this, if you look at the bottom of the sheet, until Sunday morning, May 17th is the last day that you can donate these things or give towards that. So I want to encourage you to do that and get involved that way. And I also want to put a prayer up on the screen right now. And as you're reading through that prayer, if you're here today, and the first thing Mary Jean started with today was a passage from Revelation. And she shared in that passage that that in heaven there will be people from every nation and tell them you tried. And the reality is heaven is a place after we die. We either go to heaven or hell. If we choose to live our lives for ourselves and not recognize our own disobedience of God and need for the Savior, for Jesus, then we go to hell, where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth forever. But God loves us so much, he sent his son Jesus to die on the cross for us in our place. And anyone who would choose to accept him could have eternal life in heaven. And maybe you're here today, maybe you, if you were to die right now, you don't know if you'd be in heaven. Friends, God loves you too much to leave you this way the rest of your life. But you have to choose to accept, come to him on his terms through Christ, that he died on the cross for you. As you read through that prayer, if you're sitting here today and you're thinking, you know what, I need to know that I'll be in heaven when I die, I need to pray this prayer. This really is in my heart. This is what I need to do today. If that's you, would you just be bold right now? Just raise your hand. Praise God. Praise God. Listen, friends, if you just raised your hand, whether it was for the first time or even if you didn't raise your hand, but you'd like to commit your life to Christ for the first time ever, or maybe as a serious recommitment to Jesus today, I'm gonna ask you, as we sing this last song, I'm going to ask you to go over to the left of the cross with the light there, and my sister Roxy and Pastor Jerry will meet you over there at that door, and they want to pray with you and encourage you and give you some tools to help you as you make this commitment or recommitment to Christ to take the next steps on beyond that. So I want to encourage you to do that during this song. Also, during this song, we're going to worship the Lord by returning back to him our first and best. I've taught on tithing before. It's returning the first and best 10% to the Lord Jesus through his church. We have boxes on the doors, by the doors, hanging. You can do that during this time. If you want to give online, you can pull out your phones during this time. Go to our website. You can scan the link on our bulletin that will take you to that link. And I want to encourage you to give your tithes to the Lord. But also today, I want to encourage you to pray about giving an offering to help Mary Jean with her ministry and what she does. And so we have offering is what we give above and beyond the tithe. We have buckets by each door there. We've got some guys, some ushers that are holding them. So feel free during this time to give a gift there as well. And so let's worship the Lord in song and in giving to him. And if you raised your hand, or even if you didn't, but you want to commit or recommit to God, if you go to the door over there with the light on, and Pastor Jerry and Miss Roxy would love to pray with you and encourage you and give you some stuff to go from there. So let's worship the Lord together in those ways.